We'll just let it fade out after a while, and then I'll start speaking. Okay? Yeah, well, I asked him to organise a private sale, in fact. Well, no, not necessarily need the furniture as well. Yeah, okay. Right, so three seconds to air, then. Right. Good evening, and as the thunder and lightning polka fades away, it gives me enormous pleasure to welcome you, and many others too, I'm sure, to the very first Saturday Night Fry. Let me introduce myself. My name is Stephen Fry. I stand 6'4½ in my stockinged feet, and I have a bent nose. I'm in my very late 20s. I enjoy weeding, collecting 17th-century Puritan tiaras, and dividing my time between Austrian Expressionist furniture. Now you know as much about me as I do myself. You'll forgive me for being formal, but then I like formality. Wasn't it Oscar Wilde who was imprisoned for sodomy? I don't know why I said that. I'm so sorry. Anyway, over the next few weeks, as part of a wider international government-funded experiment, I shall be presenting a series of short, half-hour radio programmes aimed at the psychosexually challenged members of the community. I'm obliged to tell you that it may be that some listeners will find parts of this programme rather badly written and incompetently performed. I hope not, but we shall see. But first, let's see what we can do about running the signature tune for you.
And you can understand just what I mean. Now all through the week it's quiet as a mouse, but on Saturday night they go from house to house. You don't have to pay the usual admission if you're a cook or a waiter or a good musician. So if you happen to be just passing by, stop in at the Saturday Night Fish Fry. It was rockin'.
Well, there you are. That was the signature tune. Now, I have an impressive lineup of guests and a repertory company of two of the most talented actors working in England today. I thought it would be a good idea for you to meet them before we began. So, for this first programme, I managed to track them down and catch up with them at the place we arranged we would meet, the BBC Radio rehearsal rooms. Firstly, I said hello to Hugh Laurie.
Ma! Is that right?
Hugh, hello.
Good afternoon to you, Stephen.
Now, Hugh, tell us something about yourself, your work.
Stephen, I've worked extensively in both television.
Mm-hmm. What sort of characters are your speciality, would you say?
I like to work younger character actors. Rustics, passed-over majors, and embittered paediatricians.
I see. What about Shakespeare?
Never have played Shakespeare, funnily enough. I don't have the height, you see. Though I did once play Christopher Marlowe in a television special. I've been in dozens of Shakespeare plays, of course. A Midsummer Night's Dream, Merchant of Venice, even to some extent Timon of Athens.
And comedy or tragedy, mostly?
If you'd ever seen my bottom at Stratford, you really wouldn't need to ask that.
Well, I did catch your bottom at Stratford, in fact.
You did? I gave my bottom opposite Peter Warner's snout, of course. I've also presented a crab in The Two Gentlemen of Verona in Bromley and Westcliff. That's Westcliff-on-Sea, of course, not the other Westcliff. If there is another one, which I doubt. Comedy is much more difficult, of course.
Why is that, I wonder?
Well, you probably didn't know this, but the essence of comedy is truth. If it isn't real, it can't be funny.
Can you give me an example of that?
If a pretend person is walking down the street and they slip on a pretend banana skin and fall down and pretend to fracture their pelvic girdle, it isn't funny. But if a real person is walking along and they slip on a real banana skin and really fracture their pelvic girdle, it is funny.
Is that right?
Oh, yes, very funny. Because it's true.
Is it?
Yes, absolutely true. Happened to my grandfather. I laughed for a week.
Well, Hugh, I'll let you get back to your work now. Thank you very much indeed.
Entirely your pleasure, Stephen. Bye.
Yes, aren't you forgetting something, Hugh?
I don't think so.
Good, good. I thought you might be, but you're not. Excellent. Now, let's, if we may, meet Emma Thompson. Emma, if I can just tear you away from the scene you're rehearsing there.
Okay, Barry, take five. I've counted how many there are in the box, so if you take more, I'll know.
Emma, hello.
Yes.
Emma, I suppose you're best known to the public for your portrayal of the neurotic, friendless madwoman who thinks she's a star. But really, you're just a wholesome girl next door, aren't you? I'm sorry, I got that wrong. You're best known as the wholesome girl next door, but really, you're just a neurotic, friendless madwoman who thinks she's a star, aren't you?
Yeah. I think the most extraordinary thing about me, Stephen, is that when I played Portia, you really believed that I was playing Portia. I even, and this is the truly frightening part, I even believed it myself. I truly believed I was playing Portia. I can't account for that.
Eerie. Emma, your list of accomplishments is startling. You write, you act, you sing, you dance, you play tragedy, comedy and magical realism. You're a well-regarded feminist and a political activist on behalf of a number of causes. How on earth do you find time to be a wife and mother?
I'm not a wife and mother.
I see. Well, ambitions?
Oh, I'd like to be a Taurian. At the moment, I'm a Sagittarian. Taurians are more rounded.
Hugh, would you like to come in here?
No, thanks. I'm happy where I am.
Right. Well, thanks to the pair of you. Well, we'll be hearing from Emma and Hugh later on in the programme. But now let's meet our studio audience. And this week it's Arnold from New Malden. Arnold, good evening.
Hello there, student.
Now, you're going to be our studio audience tonight. Mm-hmm. You'll be laughing at any humorous moments and joining in for a fair amount of the madcap revelry, I understand.
Very much hope so.
And what's your daytime job, I wonder?
I'm a bishop.
A bishop? What's that exactly?
Well, it can vary from denomination to denomination, but within the Anglican Communion, where I work, a bishop is what we call a diocesan leader. That means roughly that I am a sort of area chief, if you like. A diocese is a large region.
Oh, so you're quite senior, then?
Yes, I would say so. ecclesiastical hierarchies are as strictly defined as any.
And let's get this quite straight. This is within a church of some kind?
Yes. In my case, the Anglican Church. The Church of England.
Gotcha. So, you work in this Anglian church.
Anglican.
Right, this Anglican church. Mm. And that's what kind of work, principally? Is that manufacturing, or are you on the marketing side? PR, sales, what?
No, not really. It's administrative work, of course. But there's plenty of liturgical and canonical business as well. Baptism, confirmation, synodic work, Eucharists, the cure of
souls. Whoa. Synodic, baptism, liturgical? It looks like there's rather a lot of jargon involved here. Is it good work, Arnold? Is it something you enjoy?
I hate it, Stephen. Always wanted to be a watercolourist, but I did geography at school, and that killed landscapes for me. Still, Episcopal duties keep me busy. No time for regrets.
You know? That's right, Arnold, I bet that's right. Well, all the more kind of you to take time off from your office to...
It's a palace, rather than an office.
Yeah, right, to take time off from your palace and to come and be our audience here tonight. Have you been an audience before?
Oh, yes. I have twice been the audience for Moneybox with Louise Botting and once for Janine McMullen's A Small Country Living.
Well, you know the form, then. Yeah. Right, if you'd like to go and sit down over there, we can begin. And as Walt Teufel's Skater's Waltz fades away, it's time, of course, for Spot the Funny Noise. You've played it before, you know the rules. I play two different sound effects. One of them is funny, one isn't. You have to use your skill and judgment to decide. Now here's sound effect number one. That was sound effect number one. Now for the second.
Antihistamine. Antihistamine.
And that was sound effect number two. Which one was funny? Or was neither? Answers on a postcode only. Now, to the film of E.M. Forster's remarkable novel, Devices and Desires. I went along to the opening with witch film critic Alexander Grise. But first, let's hear an extract. Margaret Freight is engaged to the effete Edward Lefanu. Unknown to him, she's had a liaison with Riffy, an Arab boy, during a holiday in Cairo. Here, Helen, the film's heroine, played by Christine Setti, is telling Timothy Sargent, her fiancé, played by Rupert Gardner, why she can't marry him, played by June Carney. The part of Dr. Ford, Simon Cracknell, Helen's stepfather, is played by Dinsdale Denham, Julian Raft. But first, played by Richard Esterhazy, she has to tell Aunt Jane, Joan Watson, played by Lydia Helm, the actress is Frances Watling, about her fears for her sanity, a rare appearance this by the veteran actress Jill Treacher, played by Juwinda Raines. Well, what's happening here, this is the scene where the family are in the art gallery and they're looking at the Mantegna canvas. This beautifully photographed here, the camera's looking at the painting. You can hear the Mantegna theme on the oboe just there. Now the footsteps, you can hear, that's a group of German tourists who are just rushing by. They're not looking at the painting at all, which the family's... Now, we've cut to a flashback of the holiday on the Greek island of Paros. This is lovingly recreated at Shepperton Studios. There's Michael wrestling with Basil while Helen, is looking on. The fishermen are just... We've cut back to the art gallery. Jeff, is there a clip we can play with more dialogue in it? Thank you. That's it. Great. Now we're at the tea party at Mrs. Henslow's country house in Hertfordshire. And Aunt Jane is talking to Helen.
But Helen, it's all arranged. Some tea?
Arrangements? You know I hate arrangements, Aunt Jane. I thought you at least understood.
Have you told him?
I'm going to have to be brave. So is he, but I've an awful feeling that inside he won't care.
Oh, how can you say that? Timothy is devoted to you, Helen.
Oh, he's fond of me, all right. Just as he is fond of motor cars and John Buchan and almond cake.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.